Hi guys, I'm Phil Town from Rule One Investing. Today, I'm going to be reacting to the old-time 80s film, Wall Street, with Michael Douglas and Charlie Sheen, to give you my opinion on how accurate it is and what you can take away from this movie as an investor. All right, so let's take a little trip back into time to 1987 and check out a couple of amazing scenes. Here we go.
The new law of evolution in corporate America seems to be survival of the unfittest. Well, in my book, you either do it right or you get eliminated. In the last seven deals that I've been involved with, there were 2.5 million stockholders who have made a pre-tax profit of $12 billion. Thank you. I am not a destroyer of companies. I am a liberator of them. The point is, ladies and gentlemen, that greed, for lack of a better word, is good. Greed is right. Greed works. Greed clarifies, cuts through, and captures the essence of the evolutionary spirit. Greed in all of its forms. Greed for life, for money, for love, knowledge, has marked the upward surge of mankind, and greed, you mark my words, will not only save Teldar Paper, but that other malfunctioning corporation called the USA. Thank you very much.
So let me pause that for a second, because obviously the screenwriter couldn't find another word in the English language than a hugely loaded, emotionally loaded word like greed. Now, we use greed actually in Rule One Investing as a heavily loaded emotional term ourselves, because our basic concept of investing, and the secret to really successful investing, you know, is, as you guys are aware from watching these videos, is that we sell greed and we buy fear. In other words, greed in our vocabulary would be something like irrational exuberance. That would be an emotional state where investors have lost their freaking minds and are paying absurd prices for assets that aren't remotely worth what their selling price is in the market. So greed is what drives gigantic bubbles like the tulip bubble, like the South Sea bubble, like the market bubbles of 1999 and the real estate bubbles of 2007. Greed is a great word for the concept of irrationally going after something based on a complete lack of understanding of what a thing is worth, right? So the screenwriter who wrote the word greed into this has no real concept of what real investing is all about. He's got Michael Douglas, and now maybe in the context of the movie, it's perfectly appropriate, given that Michael Douglas is supposed to be this sort of monster company, you know, destroyer, right? Who buys companies that are so cheap that by disassembling them, you come up with a vast return on investment. Just by taking the company apart and selling the pieces, you do much, much better than the price of the company when he buys it. In fact, Warren Buffett did that kind of thing in one of his first investments ever. As a very young man in the 1950s, he bought a company that was public, very inexpensive company. It was super cheap, and he bought it, and it was in Nebraska someplace near Omaha. He bought this company and understood that he could take the company apart, sell off the stuff in it, and make a vast profit. And he did that, kind of the Michael Douglas scenario here. He did that not out of a state of greed, but out of a willingness to step in and buy something around which there was enormous fear. That is, the market judged this company that Buffett bought to be very scary and wouldn't therefore participate in buying its stock. Buffett stepped in, bought the whole thing, and then disassembled the company and made a profit. He also discovered, that while you should rationally be able to do something like that, there are people's lives involved in this. And as a result, he was pilloried by the press in that town, of course, because he laid off a big chunk of the people who worked in that town. And of course, they would be furious with this young, you know, startup guy that, you know, Michael Douglas could have been based on. And it was the last time Buffett ever did that. He hated the feeling of being attacked for wrecking people's lives, in spite of the fact, you know, despite the fact that it was the right thing to do from a pure financial point of view. The company was far too cheap and should have been broken up. So Buffett never did that again, ever. He stopped buying companies that were super cheap like this one. And in this clip, by the way, Douglas is criticizing the board of directors for not being very good at using the assets that they have there. And I can't remember in the Wall Street whether he was right or not about that. And it may have been something entirely different, but, you know, let's go on to scene four and see where we're going from there.
Public's out there throwing darts at a board, sport. I don't throw darts at a board. I bet on sure things.
Oh, let me stop him right there. Now, I don't remember now. In Wall Street, this guy is the bad guy. And he's trying to train this young guy on how to do this right. And he is basically saying, rule number one, he says he's betting on sure things. Now, that's what we try to do. And of course, in our world, there's no such thing as a perfectly sure thing, right? I'm not sure where he's going with that idea of sure thing. It might be that he's got some nefarious plan going here that's illegal. But in our world, we are absolutely going after certainty. And the way we get that kind of certainty is we try very hard to understand the value of the business. And therefore, we're looking at businesses that we can understand. That's just fundamental, which is a small percentage of the businesses that are out there in the world. So we're looking for something we understand well enough to put a value on it. That's reasonably accurate. And then we want to buy it at about 50% of that value. And we summarize that very simply by saying, we want to buy $10 bills for $5. So if I buy a $10 bill for $5, I have 100% certainty that I've got a sure thing. Obviously, the catch is knowing that you've got a $10 bill. Knowing that you got a $10 bill. So let's see where Michael Douglas is going with this idea of a sure thing. So for us, a sure thing, we really understand the value. We know the company is going to be a lot more valuable in the future, and we can buy it today for a big discount to that value. Let's see what he's thinking about.
Read Sun Tzu, The Art of War. Every battle is won before it's ever fought. Think about it.
Okay, I'm still with him, right? The idea that every battle is won before it's fought means that you've got a really good position on the battlefield, that you have looked at every possibility out there. And obviously there are things that can happen that you can't expect, but essentially Sun Tzu is saying that when you do it right, you've won the battle before it starts. And I'll tell you what, in special forces, special operations team, this is biblical. This is so important that it is just pounded into special operators, particularly the Green Berets, because our job was to operate asymmetrical warfare. And that means we're very outnumbered in every kind of way. So you want to think about the classic asymmetrical warfare success was the Vietnamese against America, right? Out industrialized, out weaponed, out manned, out everything. And they still won because they conducted extremely effective asymmetrical war. That means you only attack when you have an enormous benefit from that. So special forces teams learned a lot back there 50 years ago, and we have tried to conduct ourselves that way ever since, where we only take indigenous people into battle when we know we're in a position to win. So let's see what, so nothing wrong with that. I mean, the same thing here with investing. We want to know we're going to win. We want to know, for example, that this company will be bigger in 10 years, given obviously the sun cannot come up tomorrow, but short of that, this is going to be a bigger company in 10 years. And if so, then it'll be worth more in 10 years. So it's kind of like that. Let's see where he's going here.
You're not as smart as I thought you were, buddy boy. You wonder why fund managers can't beat the S&P 500? Because they're sheep. And sheep get slaughtered.
Ooh. S&P 500 beats almost all fund managers, and Michael Douglas is saying that the reason for that is because they are sheep. I think that's true, actually. That's a very intense way of saying it. Charlie Munger says it equally intensely by saying that 95% of fund managers are simply witch doctors, and they make witch doctors and shaman look good. Saying that they're sheep is another way of saying they don't really have their own minds about anything that they're buying into. What they're trying to do is keep up with everybody else. So I agree with him totally. If you see a lot of people leaving the market, then more people are going to leave the market, and then even more people are going to leave the market. And the thing works the other way around. And that's what we're seeing in the markets every day now. So let's see where he's going with this. Sheep get slaughtered.
I've been in this business since 69. Most of these Harvard MBA types, they don't add up to dog shit. Give me guys that are poor, smart, and hungry, and no feelings.
Big blast on the Harvard MBAs, and the Columbia MBAs, and the Wharton MBAs, and the Penn MBAs. I'm telling you, man, they deserve it. They are sheep. At least we're talking about those who are running funds. But they're sheep with a brain. I mean, in a way, they have learned that it doesn't pay to be a fund manager who's trying to be a Warren Buffett. If you have a year where you're down and the market's up, all those pension fund managers will yank their money out of your fund and put it somewhere else. So they've learned through lots of cautionary tales to just be sheep. Just shadow the index and you'll keep your investors. And as a result, their returns don't add up to dog. Exactly what Douglas has said. That's absolutely true. 100% true. Let's go on.
You win a few, you lose a few, but you keep on fighting.
By the way, Douglas is saying that the guys who really should do well are really people like you and me. I mean, not Wall Street types. And he's 100% right. Warren Buffett and Charlie Munger have been saying the same thing for 60 years. 60 years. That Wall Street is full of baloney, operating off of completely erroneous assumptions, the most important of which is they're assuming the market's rational when it isn't. And now that's being proven about every third year with a Nobel Prize winner. So you guys, so far, he's right on the money. Of course, what I think we're going to find out is he's also doing inside trading or some crap like that. But in terms of philosophy, this is dead on.
And if you need a friend, get a dog. There's trench warfare out there, pal.
Well, okay. You need a friend, get a dog. It isn't trench warfare out there at all. I mean, Warren Buffett's been doing this and crushing the market for the last 60 years. Charlie Munger has too. Monash Prabhai, Guy Spier, many, many, many more fund managers. I could just name them. And I'm telling you, every one of them that I've ever had a chance to meet is a super good guy. I really like this community. They are not trench warfare, anything but. These are people who are willing to help other people. They don't feel the slightest amount of pressure as a result of how they're doing in the markets because they're very long-term focus. Wall Street, that's trench warfare, all right. So the screenwriter just took a giant page out of Warren Buffett's book, read it out, and then twisted it into trench warfare, like somehow by focusing on the real value of the business, understanding what you're doing, not being a sheep, suddenly turns into trench warfare somehow, which it doesn't. It goes the other way around completely, where you aren't worried about whether those pension fund managers are going to pull their money out of your fund next week or not. You don't have that issue. And you and I, I agree with Douglas on that one. Getting people who have something to lose, right? They're not making money on other people's assets. You're investing your own money, your own capital. It's your retirement that you have at stake. And you are willing to be learning and digging and being more focused than fund managers are. And you can do it. That's the best part about all this is 100% you can do this. And I'll tell you guys, it fascinates me that the screenwriter here kind of took the right things and then twisted them into a bad guy. And you know, screenwriters do that sometimes in really good movies. If you think about that Jack Nicholson, Tom Cruise movie, Demi Moore, called A Few Good Men, where the screenwriter gave Jack Nicholson some of the best lines in the movie. Nicholson being the antagonist and the bad guy, also got to say some things I think the screenwriter wanted to say about how most of us, you know, we don't want to talk about what really goes on to protect our country, what really has to happen out there with these guys who are on a wall. We just want to talk about things that we can chat about at cocktail parties. I think there's a lot of truth to that. So often a screenwriter is going to put into the mouth of the antagonist some very unpopular things to say that he wants people to hear. And I think that may be part of what this screenwriter did. So I think we've got some great takeaways here. Number one is that, you know, investing isn't gambling. We want to have a high degree of certainty before we put a cent of money into an investment. And also keep your emotions out of it. You just got to stay rational, all right? And those are two great takeaways from this. And that screenwriters can often put truth into the mouth of the bad guy. Kind of cool. Now, I'd love to hear from you guys. Are there any other movies that I should cover in future videos? Because it's kind of fun. Leave a comment below with your answer. I'll be sure to follow up with you. And thanks for watching, you guys. Now go play. Hey, guys, if you enjoyed this video and you feel it was valuable in teaching you more about what's actually going on during Wall Street, the movie, hit the like button and please share this video with your friends. And if you want more investing content, subscribe to my channel, guys. And don't forget, click the button on the screen. It's got a free gift for you. Thanks again for watching.